see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life.
Praise God. At this time, to the same Lord who has saved us from our wretchedness, let us sing Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest.
Things unseen.
Time we sing, heal my heart and make it clean. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart. Amazing grace. We love you, Lord. For the last time, we sing Hosanna.
Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna.
Standing, shall we bow our heads as I pray. Lord, we give you thanks for your faithfulness in our lives, for moving amongst us and leading us into worship. We truly acknowledge your presence in our midst. Lord, as we bow before your grace, forgive us and cleanse us of our iniquities and incline your ears to our plea, that we may intercede according to your will and your way. Lord, we pray for the nation of Chile as they campaign for a new constitution to replace. May peace and justice prevail, and yours will be done. We also pray for those who are seeking peace and comfort in life. May you heal their troubled heart. May they find refuge in you in the midst of their pain. Push them through the dark moments that they may realize you are with them every step of the way. And as the world celebrates Teachers' Day this week, I pray for all the teachers and educators under NCF. May they continue the teaching ministry of Christ. Empower them by your Spirit to see the needs of the students and inspire those under their care. Lord, we also pray for the big and small ministries under Naga Christian Fellowship. As we reach out to different people and minister to them, may we not only grow in numbers, but be spiritually rooted in you and be your faithful servants and believers. We also continue to pray for the church building project. Bless those who have generously contributed towards the building project and also continue to open up ways so that the vision to build the church may be accomplished, and glory be to your name alone. Lord, we are thankful and grateful for your protection, for leading us and guiding us this past 8 months. We continue to seek your love and mercy to go with us. I surrender all our supplications unto your loving hand. I say this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Yes, thank you, worship team, for leading us into a time of meaningful one. And also, Ms. Vivoli, for interceding on behalf of the church. Yes, church, thank you for your prayers. Thank you so much for supporting our ministry thus far. We have entered into a new season. We have stepped in into the bird month. We also call it birth seasons. This is September. And God has been faithful and kind to us, leading us throughout these months. And this season is also a reminder to all of us that we are very near to the ending of 2022. It's also a reminder to all of us to revisit what we have decided in the beginning of the year. If we have not speak out to our near and dear ones, it's time to do that now. If we have decided to complete the Bible reading this year, if we have not, it's time to revisit again, to think over again. And if we have not forgive someone else, the year of 2022 will soon be ending. It's time to seek out and to care and to love one another. If you have not visited your family members for a long time, it's time to decide now. And God has been good to all of us that he has led us through this new season. As we step into these birth seasons, let the peace and the goodness of Christ be with you all and also in your families. Yes, church, I, on behalf of the church leadership team, would like to welcome if there is anyone who is worshiping with NCF Pune for the first time, who is here for the first time. I would like to request you to stand wherever you're seated. Anyone who are here for the first time. Yes, we have a brother here, a sister there. The ushers kindly hand over our connect card as well as our newsletter. Church, shall we welcome them? Thank you so much for being here. We warmly welcome you. And if you're looking for a place to worship, NCF Pune welcome you to be a part of this family. We worship here in this church at 11:30 a.m. You're most welcome even in the days to come. Church, we will continue to worship the Lord by collecting our offerings and tithes. So I request the ushers to come forward. And also Mrs. Appem to come forward and say the offertory prayer. Kindly, the ushers come forward.
Let's pray for the offering. Our most loving Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day that you've given us in our life to gather here and worship you in your holy place. Thank you, Lord, for providing our needs. Thank you, Lord, for our life, our health, our family, and saving us from our sins. Lord, I pray for the offerings, tithes, thanksgiving. I pray all these things into your mighty name. In Jesus' most precious name, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Oh, Thank you, Ms. Colo McCruz, for leading us the offertory hymn. Now we have a song presentation from Mrs. Deborah Tavilo. I invite her for the time.
So this song is very special to me. I learned it when I was 15 years old. And it is very special because it makes me wonder how heaven it is. And I know heaven is where God is, God's presence. And I want to encourage you this week and the rest that comes, that you can close your eyes and just let God's love change you every day.
Meditation, the scripture portion is from the book of Proverbs, chapter 6, verse 16 to 19. Proverbs, chapter 6, verse 16 to 19. There are six things the Lord hates. No, seven things he detests. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that kill the innocent, a heart that plots evils, feet that race to do wrong, a false witness who pours out lies, a person who sows discord in a family. This is the word of God. Now we shall hear the sermon from Pastor Lungria. I give the rest of time to him.
Greetings to you all in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am privileged to be standing here today and share the word of God with you all. I'd like to start with a short story. Once a doctor, an engineer, and a pastor went out into a jungle for hunting, and they made a deal to shoot at the target in a count of 1, 2, and 3. So fortunately, they killed a deer. They went, checked the deer, and they found out only one person shot the target, and the bullet went through from one side of the ear and passed through. They started to argue whose shot was that. So they were having that argument. But they were not able to solve it. In the midst of the argument, a lawyer came all alone hunting. So he came and promised them that, "I will solve the problem." And he said boldly like this, "That shot was a shot of pastor." And that moment they were all shocked and they wondered how. And this is how the lawyer responded. "Every time a pastor speaks or preaches in the church, the congregation hears it and let it go from the other side of the ear." So this is obviously a made-up story. I didn't want to mention joke in the beginning because if you don't find funny, I don't want to be embarrassed later. So this is obviously a made-up story. But this story somehow depicts with the topic which we're going to discuss today. We definitely know what is not right to do and which we are asked not to do things. Example, the Ten Commandments, we all know that. But as imperfect human beings, we commit mistakes, we commit sins, here or the other, one way or the other, knowingly or unknowingly. So the topic for today is seven detestations to the Lord from Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 to 19. And by the way, the preaching here, we have started with a series. The first was taken by Dr. Mai Song the previous Sunday, and this is the second preaching from the book of Proverbs. So this is how we will go in this sermon. This is how the pastoral team has made it as a sermon series. So we all look to God in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your love and your amazing grace. Lord, we come here in your presence this afternoon. Come in our hearts and teach us to keep things that you want us to do in our hearts and obey them, and not to listen and just let it go again. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Some people are of opinion that since God is love, he doesn't hate anything. But we should realize that since he loves righteousness and holiness so much, we should also know that he also hates the opposite, that is sin. Today we will be talking about the seven things that God hates. The whole structure of this passage, verses 16 to 19, the whole structure and the arrangements of these thoughts comes in a flow along with the preceding verses. This is not an independent passage. So it goes like this. And the object of this is to show that those evil qualities of deceit and malice which are disastrous to men are equally odious in the sight of God. Yeah. So, verse 16. There are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him. Some commentary says that this numerical number used here is a numerical parallelism, whereas some thought this is a common gnomic literature pattern of Arabia or Persia. However, this is the way how the author of this book, Proverbs, writes it. We will find this numerical form even in other chapters as well. The word detestation means the feeling of hating someone or something very much. The synonym of detestation is abomination. And Strong's dictionaries defined abominations. Abominations are things that are particularly disgusting and abhorrent in the sight of God. We have the first point of the seven detestations. Haughty eyes. Haughty eyes is also translated as arrogant eyes or proud look. And this is a sin. Haughty eyes is a sin. This is a sin where other people look down on others, considering others, considering himself or herself better or smarter than anybody else. Underestimating others in terms of spirituality, knowledge, or intellect, or whatsoever. And such people are arrogant. They are unteachable. They are judgmental, and they are rebellious. And such people are not appreciated or not loved by God. Such people are detestable in the eyes of God as well, because such people inspire division and inspire rebellion in the body of Christ and in the place, in a community, in a harmonious community. They inspire rebellion and divisions. Therefore, God doesn't want that, doesn't like that. God hates pride. That it should be no surprise to us that this proud look comes first, as it is also recorded in Bible as a first sin. We can see the life or the story from Lucifer, the anointed seraph, became proud, and as a result, he lost his lofty position in heaven. Isaiah 14 records the pride of Lucifer, whereas Ezekiel 28 records the response to God responds to Lucifer's pride. God hates pride so much that he threw Lucifer out of heaven. And even James says like this, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. James 4:6. And we have the second detestation is lying tongue. A lying tongue is that speaks falsehood knowingly and willingly with the intention to deceive someone. You cannot trust anything coming out from a wicked man's mouth. But our God is not like that. God's intention is clear, and we can see from Titus 1 and 2 that God cannot lie. So God doesn't love who lie. God doesn't like lies. Like, God has a real love for truth, and for that reason, he has a real hatred for lies as well. God declared himself that he is the truth in John 14, and declared Satan as liar in John 8. There is nothing that God like about lying. So we read from Acts chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. Acts chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. It reads like this. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died, and great fear seized all who heard what had happened. The Bible encourages us to speak the truth. Lying is not of God, and lying is not from God. Lying is something God really doesn't like it. A false witness will not go unpunished, and who tells lies will not escape. That is what Proverbs 19:5 says. And the third we have is hands that shed innocent blood. This is listed in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not murder. And if we are to just see and read it, these are all self-explanatory. But anyway, the Lord values its life, and its life belongs to him. Because God is just, he hates when innocent people are being punished and the guilty ones being rewarded. God really hates that. We may never have the orchestra of killing someone or having a knife or a gun in our hands with the intention to kill someone, but you know what? Matthew records like this, murder starts from our hearts. Murder starts from our hearts. Anyone hating someone else unreasonably without offering a room for forgiveness commits a sin equally to murder. That is what Matthew records it. We have the fourth. The fourth is a heart that devises wicked schemes. When God created human being, every single part of the body was so good. And likewise, God created our minds to imagine good things. He wants us to use our amazing brains to understand him. He wants us to use our curiosity to discover him, rather than to imagine evil things. One of the major reasons why God sent a devastating flood to Noah in Noah's time was because of this wickedness. As explained in Genesis 6:5, then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of the heart was only evil continually. No wonder why God hates a heart that devises wicked imagination or wicked plans. Man's problem is a wicked heart. As Jesus pointed out in Matthew 15:19-20, you can read it out later. There we will find how a man's wicked heart is. The fifth we have is feet that are quick to rush into evil. Feet that are quick to rush into evil. God hates feet that are quick into evil. In the moral context, it denotes activities which is contrary to God's will. One of the examples from Bible is Eve in the Eden Garden. She had the first experience of temptations from the devil. She displayed no resistance to the serpent's attractions towards the fruit. Eve got attracted to the fruit. She saw the tree as a good food or a pleasing thing in her eyes. Eve has sinned at that moment itself. But when we look into the life of Jesus, we have read, we have studied again and again that Jesus, when he retired from his fasting of 40 days and 40 nights, the devil came and tempted him. But Jesus paid no attention, or Jesus refused to yield to the devil's temptation that we all know. Today is even more dangerous for our generations, the technological age. The ability to broadcast evil events on our screens, and which can lead us quickly to the place where it's detestable, which is not good for the immoral activities. We should always remember what God says. Even here in James 4:7 says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Resist the devil, he will flee from you. The sixth we have is a false witness who pours out lies. A false witness who pours out lies. This is similar to the lying tongue mentioned earlier, but this form of lying is given special mention, as it could send an innocent person into jail or an innocent person being stoned to death. We have a story from Bible, a person named called Naboth. Naboth was being stoned to death, though he was innocent, just because he said he refused the plea of the King Ahab. So King Ahab refused to sell his vineyard to the King Ahab. Ahab's wife, Jezebel, instigated false witness on Naboth, and that's how he was killed, stoned. We see that in 1 Kings 21. The ninth of the Ten Commandments, the whole New Testament, equally prohibits against lying. That we should know, and of course we all know. The seventh and the final detestation is a person who stirs up conflicts in the community. The last detestation or abomination listed may seem minor compared to the above 6 points, such as murder, such as like shedding innocent blood. But spreading strife among those who should be in harmony is equally dangerous and this sin is equally dangerous, and it matters a lot. Strife among brothers and even within the church, sometimes it's unavoidable, it happens. But the thing is, if there is anyone who does things purposely to bring corruption in the midst of peace, that is what God doesn't like it, and that is what it says here. So this is, in other way, one of the worst sins in God's eyes. God's desire for brothers are to dwell in unity. Psalmist says like this, how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. Psalms 133:1. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is our love and unity that we portray, that we tell to the people that we are the disciples of Jesus. It is the love and the unity and the peace that we have that shows others that we are the disciple of Jesus. And if there is anyone who purposely try to break that, and that's one of the worst things, that God doesn't like it. And in fact, even we, as human, we don't like that. There are many more things that are detestable to the Lord, not just the 7 points, such as sexual perversions, homosexuality, or prostitutions, or a child sacrifice. We can name it. But for today, we discuss this. Yeah. I would like to conclude with three very strong points from the Word of God, and they are very important to each one of us. Let's go. Number one I would like to give you today is, tell you today is, the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death. Many people try to find out excuses and make a way out from sin, saying that sin is just like something else. Let's do it. It's not a big deal. People try to do that. But I tell you, sin is serious. And the wages of sin is death. We should know that. We must know that. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. Yeah. We cannot take sin lightly. Sin is serious, and we cannot afford to commit sin knowingly. We must not sin at all. And the second thing I would like to give you all is, let you all know, is that God hates the sin but loves the sinners. God hates the sin but loves the sinner. Like it or not, the passages like this are uncomfortable for us nowadays, for the Christians. Passages like this are uncomfortable. But the good thing is that God still loves the sinners. Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrated his love to us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let me repeat it again, because this verse has so much to speak to each one of us. And let's try to ponder this very deeply. And imagine how powerful this verse has. Romans 5:8. God demonstrated his love to us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It's, in other ways, simple a reminder that God hates sin but loves sinner. And the third thing I would like to give you all is God came for the sinners to repentance. Some people may think that they are far away from God and they dare even coming close to the church leaders, the pastors, or the servants of God. In a way, I find that that itself is a humbleness. Giving respect or kind of, such things, I find it that itself is a humbleness. Then to think ourselves as righteous and to be proud of. Because the Lord himself doesn't like the proud, as we have read earlier. Isaiah says, even your efforts at righteousness are as filthy rags before him. So which means we can clearly see that with our potentials, with our goods, we have nothing to impress God. God loves us as who we are. God loves sinners. God loves as who we are. And we just have to be humble than to be acting as a righteous and to be proud. Jesus himself declared, he didn't come for the righteous but sinners to repentance. As we go through these 7 points, 7 abominations or detestations that God hates, perhaps you realize yourself or you see yourself in one way or the other as guilty. Just remember that to restore your relationship with God, with the Lord, is simply a matter of honesty and confession. He is just to forgive your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Your sins may be great, but Christ's forgiveness of sinners is greater. Oscar Wilde said, and I quote, every saint has a past and every sinner has a future, unquote. In other words, every pastor has a past and every sinner has a future. The fact that we are all here this morning, this afternoon, is just because God loves us. And we need to acknowledge that. He's inviting us, he's reminding us, even today, at this moment, to his table, to be a part of his body. So I urge, why not we just come as who we are? And like I said earlier, it's just a matter of honesty and confession, which we can build a good relationship with God. Let's come into the Lord's table with a humble heart. And may our Lord's communion, Lord's Supper, Holy Communion today be as meaningful as it will be in your life and for the rest of your life. Now I hand over the time to continue to our pastor.
Yes, as the word has come clearly to all of us that God hates sin, but he loves all of us and he gives hope to all of us. And today, the table, the Lord's table, is his sign of his love towards us. As sinful race, sinful people like us, he gave us hope, and this table is his love for us. Let me read out the scripture verse for all of us, adding to what our speaker has spoken to us. It is from Micah
Micah chapter 7, verse 19, it says, "You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea." And Christ, who sacrificed, who was slain on the cross, died for our sins to forgive us once and for all. Nothing more than that. And today I would like to invite all of us to the Lord's table who are baptized and who have personal relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us prayerfully come to the table and partake what the Lord has asked to do in remembrance of Him. I request the ushers to come forward. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He gave thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." May I request Nigatoli to pray for the bread?
Let us pray. Lord, we are grateful for your body that you have broken for us.
May I request Chuba to pray for the cup?
Let us pray. Our Lord, our God, at this very moment, Lord, we pray over this cup.
Church, the ushers will bring the elements to each one of us. After the distribution of the elements, we will partake together. Shall we prayerfully partake the bread together? Let's also prayerfully partake together the cup. O Lord, Father, we thank you for the word that has come to us. Lord, help us to keep in our hearts and know and to flee from the sins, from temptations. But Lord, help us to look at you, to seek you, to read your word, and to live the Christ-likeness in our life. Father, we also ask of your grace and love and your blessing to our friends who are not present here, who are not able to attend the church today because of their sicknesses, because of their own problems. Oh Lord God, may you bless them as well, like the way we have received your blessing today. And now, as we have come to the end of our service, May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit may raise and abide with each one of you, now and forevermore. Amen. I would like to request our worship leader to come forward, Lilo, to lead into a time of singing the blessing song.